grace. But if it's of works, it's no longer grace. Otherwise, work is no longer work. And I purposely circled the grace and I purposely squared the works because they don't fit together. If it's by grace, it's unmerited. If it's by works, you must earn it. You must deserve it. It's a reward. If it's by grace, it is a gift. And thus, Romans 4, verses 4 and 5 says, but to him who works, the wages, that which you earn, are not counted as grace, but as debt. So works, wages, and debt go together. But to him who does not work, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Notice how grace and faith fit wonderfully together. Because in faith, you do not try to earn salvation. You rely on someone else to provide it for you and to give it to you as a gift, not a reward. And thus Ephesians 2:8-9 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. And that contrast is so very, very important. Now I illustrated this last time again with a pure gospel and a false gospel. The pure gospel is one of grace. It is when you recognize that you are an unworthy, hopeless, helpless, hellbound sinner, but that Jesus Christ died for you. God became a man and paid for your sins on the cross. And on the third day, he rose again victorious to provide for you salvation as a gift. You don't earn it. You don't work for it. It's all by his grace. In contrast to that, when one tries to work, they make salvation a reward. Now, if it is finished and Christ did everything on the cross, how could it possibly be a reward? It's paid in full. It's offered in love. It's received through faith because it is a gift. And a gift and grace go perfectly together. And so that's the pure gospel of grace. On the other hand, if you then simply add even one work to this message of grace, it is no longer a grace message. And then there are some who come along and say, well, it's not just one work. Mercy, you've got to do this, and you got to do that, and you got to do this, and you got to do that, and you got to do that, and then make sure you endure to the end. And instead of it clearing up the problem remains, and you're even more entrenched. Because this is not the message of grace. Now, just like Ephesians 2:8-9 has contrasted these two, we have done the same. And we use the illustration with the flashlight again. You can always tell a true gospel from a false gospel. A true gospel always points you to Christ. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you'll be saved. A false gospel may mention Christ, but then turns the flashlight on you and what you must now do for God. The Bible's clear. It's not of yourself. It's not of works, lest anyone should boast. So again, there are two basic approaches. It's either salvation by works or it's salvation by grace through faith alone. It's one or the other. It cannot be both. It's either faith in Christ, period, or faith in Christ plus, because he did it all or he didn't do it all. It's one or the other. And so every false response you hear, just ask yourself, where's the flashlight? Ask yourself, is it a gift or a reward? Ask yourself, is the pure gospel or a false gospel? Now, many people who preach a false gospel do not think, obviously, that it's a false gospel, nor do they think they're even adding works. Sometimes they'll tell you it's not by works, and then they will tell you three things to do. And so, therefore, there is mass confusion. And if there's any message that Satan would want to confuse, obviously, it is this message. And so we began going through some of these false conditions and clarifying the confusion, like believe in Jesus Christ and give your life to him or give your life to Jesus. Now again, the problem with that is Jesus did not come to receive our life, but to freely give us his life when we believe on him alone. Salvation does not come by giving. Salvation comes by receiving. It's not you giving God something, it's God giving you something, and that's why the direction of the gospel is always from God to you, never from you to God. We then looked at the confusion, believe in Jesus Christ, and repent of your sins to be saved. Again, when you think of that, where does the flashlight go? It goes right back on you. Repent of your sins to be saved. Number one, that phrase is not found in the Bible. The word repent is found, but repent from your sins is not found. And while there are contexts in which sin is the issue that one must repent from, that is a context for a believer, like 2 Corinthians chapter 7. It's for a believer who's already been justified before God. You see, if you have to repent from your sins, question what sins? How many? How often? How do you know you have? Furthermore, the issue ultimately isn't the sin issue, it's the son issue. For he that believes in Christ is not condemned, but he that does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God, John 3:18. And while we would readily admit that you have to admit that you are a sinner in need of a Savior, otherwise why would you be saved? It's not a matter of repenting from your sin. Since your sins have been paid for by Jesus Christ, the need to change your mind or repent about trust in anything but Jesus Christ to save you is the issue. You're changing your mind about Christ and what he did, and therefore you're changing your mind about relying on any of your works to be saved. We then saw that justification does not come through rituals. And I call your attention to Romans 4 again, verse 9. Does this blessedness of justification then come upon the circumcised only, namely the Jews, or upon the uncircumcised also? For we say that faith was accounted to Abraham for righteousness. How then was it accounted? While he was circumcised or uncircumcised? Not while circumcised, but while uncircumcised. He was justified in Genesis 11:12. He was declared such in Genesis 15, and he wasn't circumcised until Genesis 17. So how could it be necessary to be circumcised if he was already justified before he ever did it? Verse 11, and he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had while still being uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all those who believe, though they are uncircumcised, that righteousness might be imputed to them also. How? By faith. And the father of circumcision to those who not only are of the circumcision, but also who walk in the steps of the faith which our father Abraham had while still uncircumcised. And so we see here that justification does not come through a ritual, even a biblically commanded ritual, which circumcision was in the Old Testament. In doing so, we then clarified the confusion, believe in Jesus Christ and be baptized to be saved. The clarification is water baptism is a public testimony of salvation for believers, not a means of salvation for unbelievers. It's a way to publicly identify with Jesus Christ in view of the real identity you now have in Christ, co-crucified, co-buried, and co-raised with him. And thus, when you are baptized, you are publicly proclaiming, I believe Christ died for my sins, was buried and rose again. I have been identified with him, and I proclaim that testimony to you through that means. We then looked at the statement, well, you need to confess Christ publicly to be saved. And again, once again, there is a work added to this message of grace. Once again, the flashlight comes on you instead of on Christ. The clarification, Romans 10 is written for the Jews, exhorting them to agree that Jesus is Lord and approved of God, and therefore they should believe on him for salvation. We then looked at believe in Jesus Christ and confess your sins to be saved. And the clarification is confession of known sin is necessary for the believer to have fellowship with God, not for salvation from hell. And in fact, 1 John 1:9, which is the classic verse on confession, clearly is a verse that deals with fellowship. 1 John 1:3 says that. 1 John 1:6 says that. 1 John 1:7 says that as well. And thus, the moment you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you are born again. You become a member of the family of God here, and you now can have fellowship with God. Sin again breaks fellowship, turning back to the Lord, i.e., or confession as needed, restores you to fellowship so that you can learn to again walk by faith in the Son of God who loved you and gave himself for you. Paul then explains in Romans 4, 13 through 15, that justification does not come through the law. And again, the law's proposition is very simple. Obey and you will be blessed. Disobey and you will be cursed. Again, it has to fit in one of the two. It's either salvation by works or salvation by grace. So, obey and keep the law. Where does the flashlight go? Right on me, right? Takes it from Christ, puts it on me. Therefore, it is a message of works. It's not the pure message of grace. It makes salvation a reward for what you've done instead of a gift for what Christ has done. Now, as we think of that, keep in mind, just from a chronological standpoint, that in the plan of God for the ages, he has various dispensations. Dispensations are economies. They're ways of life. They are not means of salvation. No one was ever saved in various ways throughout the ages. They were always saved one way, by grace, through faith, in the Lord, apart from works, law, and ritual. That's Paul's whole point in Romans 4. Now, it is true in the plan of God, however, that man began with innocence. He was given a test in which he failed, and the result was Adam and Eve sinned. There then came the curse and death. From that point forward, they now had a conscience, and God definitely said, in essence, I want you to live according to your conscience. But we know that conscience failed them. They rebelled against their conscience even. And so that God saw the wickedness of man and was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually, and it grieved the Lord that he had made man. And he said, I will destroy man out of the face of the earth. He said, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Notice Noah found grace. He didn't earn grace. He found it. And thus God judged the pre-flood world with a universal flood, a global flood. Now, was life different before the fall than after the fall? Absolutely. Was life different before the flood than after the flood? Absolutely. And then God established human government. And for the first time in the history of mankind, God gave man the right to govern other men, and for capital crime to even execute capital punishment. And he told them to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth just like he did previously. But they rebelled, and under the leadership of Nimrod, they started to build the Tower of Babel, and God again judged. Every dispensation began with blessing. Everyone ends with judgment. Everyone is showing this, that apart from the grace of God, man is a flop and a failure. On the other hand, every dispensation is showing that God is gracious and God is faithful to his word. He makes promises and he keeps them. And thus, God then judged by way of confusing the languages at the Tower of Babel. In doing so, he set up the divine institution of nationalism for a balance of power. And then we move into the dispensation of promise. And God now does something unique. Prior to that, he dealt with everyone who was a Gentile, and now he forms a new nation through Abraham. This nation would be the nation of Israel through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he makes these promises, these covenants to them. And these covenants were grace covenants. They did not demand obedience to be blessed. God said, I will, I will, I will, I will. It's not until the law that he will say, if you do, then I will. Now, we're going to see that Paul understands this and makes this an issue here in this chapter. So was life different before the Tower of Babel than after? Absolutely. And God blessed them. He gave them a land. He gave them spiritual blessings. He made promises, some promises that are yet to be fulfilled. But they left the land, they stayed out of the land, and became slaves in the land of Egypt for 450 years. And as a result, God judged once again. And then he raised up Moses, who delivered Israel out from Egypt through the Red Sea with the high hand of power. And then they made their way down to Mount Sinai, where God gave them the law. Now, from a mere chronological standpoint, how could Abraham have been justified by law if the law wasn't given? For hundreds of years later. There's no way. But remember, the law came from God. The law was just, holy, and good. The problem was not with the law. The problem was with man's inability to keep the law. And man under law, Israel under law, was a miserable flop and a failure once again. In fact, finally, when God brought the Messiah onto the scene, the Lord Jesus Christ, and offered them the kingdom on earth, if they would simply put their faith in him, they rejected him and instead relied on the righteousness of the law, Romans 9, 30 through 33. And as a result, the Romans then crucified our Lord, and on that cross he died for our sins. He was then buried, and on the third day he rose again. And he offers salvation to all. And this dispensation of law ended, which focused again on the nation of Israel. And through the death of Christ, salvation has now been made available to all. Now keep this clear. No one was ever saved in the Old Testament by offering animal sacrifices. They were a picture of the ultimate sacrifice, but they were saved by faith. Abraham was justified by faith. David was justified by faith, not by anything he did. We know that Christ said, predictively during his earthly ministry, I will build my church. And he sent the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. And thus, after the cross, we have the dispensation of grace, and we have the church age, and that's what he's doing today. And we recognize there's coming a day in which he will snatch his church away to be with him. There will then be the tribulation on earth. And then Jesus Christ will return in all his second coming glory to set up his kingdom on earth, the first phase being for 1,000 years. There will then be the great white throne judgment where all the unsaved have their day in court. And prior to this, the devil and his angels are cast into the lake of fire at that same time. And everyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And then we have the new heavens and new earth. Now, this is the plan of God. This plan is designed to bring glory to God. The salvation of man is an important piece of the puzzle, but not the whole piece. You see, the real plan of God has to do with far more than the salvation of man. It has to do with the salvation of the planet. by virtue of the fact that the scepter that Adam held was forfeited to Satan when he sinned. And as a result, Satan gave a legitimate offer to Jesus Christ when he came the first time, when he said, "See all the kingdoms of the world, you bow down and I'll give you those kingdoms." Now, he didn't say, "Oh, you didn't own those kingdoms." Oh, no. He owned them. He owns the kingdoms of the world. He has the scepter of the planet in his hands, but it'll be wrestled away from him by Jesus Christ when he is defeated at the Battle of Armageddon. The kingdom will then be set up, and while Satan is bound for 1,000 years, at the end of the 1,000 years, he's loosed again, finds a waiting army, marches on Jerusalem, and fire from heaven destroys them, according to Revelation chapter 20, verses 7 through 9. And so the salvation of man is an important thread through the plan of God, but it's much bigger than that. It's bigger than you. It's bigger than me. As God has a plan for the angels, God has a plan for Satan, God has a plan for the planet, God has a plan for various things, and the dispensations define the plan and describe the plan, and the covenants of God drive the plan. And I'm going to say that a lot of times during your education here in Gibbs, that the dispensations define it and describe the plan of God, the covenants drive it. Now, from a pure historical, chronological approach, how could justification ever be by law over here when Abraham was justified right here? There's no way it could. And you see, that's his point. Abraham was justified before the law. Verse 13, for the promise that he would be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. And so God's promise to Abraham was not based on law. It wasn't based on law, didn't come through the law. The law wasn't even around when God made that promise. Instead, God's promise to Abraham was based on the principle of grace. And remember, what's the only thing consistent with grace? It is what? Faith. So what do we read? Again, verse 13, for the promise that he would be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Well, it's of faith, and it's got to be by grace. That's the whole point. And if it's of grace, it can't be by works. If it's by grace, it can't be by law. It's got to be based on a provision God made and a promise he offered. And thus, justification by law is contrary to the principle of faith. It's contrary to the principle of faith. Verse 14, for if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void, please note that, and the promise made of no effect. And so we see a person who approaches God based on law makes God's grace ineffective, unnecessary, meaningless, void, of no effect. When you add works to grace, you nullify it. You can't be saved by faith plus works or plus law. Otherwise, it's not by grace. And that is why in Galatians 3:10 we read, for as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. You see, if you depend upon the works of the law, then you're under the curse, not under the blessing. Because, again, the law demands 100% obedience, 100% of the time, 100% of the law. You can't measure up, and neither can I. Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. So based upon Christ being redeemed, he's redeemed us because he was willing to be cursed. He made him a curse for us. again, we see the doctrine of substitution. Galatians 3:19, what purpose then does the law serve? It was added because of transgressions till the seed should come. Who's the seed? Jesus Christ, to whom the promise was made, and it was appointed through angels by the hand of a mediator. That's why Galatians 2:21, I do not set aside the grace of God. For if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain. In other words, if the law, which came from God, was the means of salvation, if you could somehow be declared righteous before God based on the law, then tell me, why did Jesus Christ have to come? Why did he die? What did it accomplish? Why was it necessary? The fact is, if salvation is by law, then Christ died for nothing. That's Paul's point in Galatians 2:21. That's his point here in Romans chapter 4. And thus, as you think of the law approach with this, again, the scales of righteousness, as they were, you see how the work of Christ outweighs any effort of obedience to the law for salvation. Secondly, we see in verse 15 that the law can only condemn, it cannot save. Verse 15 says, because the law brings wrath. Did you catch that? The law brings wrath. It doesn't bring justification. It doesn't bring righteousness. It declares righteousness. It demands righteousness, but it does not provide righteousness. For there, where there is no law that defines sin, then there is no transgression of a defined law, because there's no definition of sin, as it were, and declaration of what it is. But the whole point here is the law brings about wrath. Wrath. And so it's very clear from Paul's argument, we're not justified by law. Now again, there are people who will say, you're not justified by the law, and then they will tell you law kind of things to do. So one of the things we hear today is believe in Jesus Christ and keep the Ten Commandments to be saved. Now it comes in a lot of different ways. I remember talking to a man about a year or so ago. He was selling books in the area for a religious organization. And when I talked to him, he said, oh, I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. In fact, I have a quiet time every day. I said, really? Well, that's interesting. I said, can I ask you a question? If you were to commit a serious sin like adultery, not that all sin isn't sin, but, you know, just one of the Ten Commandments, and you don't confess that, or get that right with God, and you die, are you going to go to heaven? He says, I don't know. I said, oh, so what you're really saying is you have to believe in Jesus Christ and keep the law. Now, it's true, God doesn't want us to sin after we're saved. But the fact of the matter is, are we declared righteous? Are we saved by grace, or is it by keeping the law? You see, the Word of God teaches that everyone disobeys the Ten Commandments. Ecclesiastes 7:20, there's not a just man on the earth who does good and does not sin. And that was written during the dispensation of law. Galatians 2:16, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. And part of the works of the law was keeping the Ten Commandments. So again, as we pointed out before, that the law was designed to be like a mirror. So that as you looked into the mirror, you would come to the right conclusion. I am guilty. I have sinned. I have lied. I have disobeyed my parents. I have not put God first. I've used the Lord's name in vain. I have coveted. I have stolen, or whatever. And you see yourself from God's point of view, and that is needed because we're prone to usually evaluate ourselves from man's point of view and compare ourselves with someone else that at least we think they're worse than we are, though in their list, they might think they're better than you are. And so that's our tendency, right? We look into the mirror. It's not something that's in touch with reality. Galatians 6:3 says, "For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself." And that's why when I go over the gospel presentation in the John 3:16 diagram that you learned early in this series, that I always like to take the time to go over the Ten Commandments and some of them and have them really come to grips with the fact they've sinned. I always really like to go over the fact that if we sin just 10 times a day in thought, word, deed, and motive, just 10, that's 3,650 sins a year. You ask the person how old they are, and they got to be careful with ladies sometimes. And then you add it up right in front of them. Do the math right in front of them. I did this here recently, 140,000 sins. And I said, that's only a 10 a day, and as a teenager, you're way over that. And they look back like, wow. And I said, remember, heaven is a perfect place for perfect people. It's morally perfect, it's holy, it's without sin. How are you ever going to get in? You're 140,000 over the limit already. And that's only a 10 a day. You see, I'm using the law lawfully, 1 Timothy 1, to show someone they are a sinner. Because in self-deception, grace is not really needed. I'm not all that bad. But in reality, grace should be embraced because I have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and the penalty for sin is death. And so the law proves that everyone is guilty before God. And we've underscored that earlier in Romans 3:19 and 20. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh shall be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. Thirdly, the law was designed not to save us, but to lead us to Christ to save us. By underscoring our need, by underscoring we are hopeless, helpless, and hellbound sinners. Galatians 3:24 and 25, therefore the law was our tutor. Why? To bring us to Christ. To bring us to Christ that we might be justified by faith. But after faith has come, we're no longer under a tutor, namely the law. And so the clarification is, though the law can show us that we are sinners, it cannot save us from our sins. It can't save us. It was never designed to save us. It was never designed to justify a sinner, per se. And that's why, as you compare law versus grace, law, under law, God prohibits and requires. Under grace, God beseeches and bestows. The law brings condemnation. Grace brings forgiveness. The law curses. The grace redeems us from the curse. The law kills. Grace makes alive. Law shuts all mouths before God. Grace opens mouths to praise God. Law brings distance between guilty man and God, where grace reconciles and draws us near to God. Under law, it was an eye for an eye. Under grace, it's turn the other cheek. Under law, it was do and live. Under grace, it's believe and live. Under law, the law condemns the best man, while grace justifies the worst man. Law is a system of probation. Grace is a system of favor, undeserved favor. The law came by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. What a great difference it is. And that is Paul's point here. We're not justified by law. Now, along those same lines is another version of you're justified by law, but it goes like this. Believe on Jesus Christ and live a holy life to be saved. Now, keep in mind, no one's against a holy life. As again, God saves us from sin, not to sin. But again, as you think of believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, once you see the and, you know you got a problem, right? Once you move, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and live a holy life, we've just shifted from grace to works. We've just shifted from a gift to a reward. And we have corrupted the gospel of grace. Now, we have seen, as we think of this, how holy must your life be? That would be the first question I would ask. Believe on Jesus Christ and live a holy life to be saved. What did you learn from Romans 2 when Kurt taught it? And Romans 2 explains that it is impossible to live a completely holy life. The demands are too great. The Lord Jesus was emphasizing the same thing on the Sermon on the Mount when he said in Matthew 5:20, "For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven." You needed more than a human righteousness. You needed a divine righteousness that was put to your account. And thus, Jesus declared that even the most religious of his day did not live a holy enough life to be justified by one's holy life. You say, well, isn't there a command somewhere in the Old Testament? Is it repeated in the New about be holy for I am holy? There is. In fact, go with me to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. Now remember, when you study the Bible, you must always take into consideration its context. You then must observe its content. And you then need to compare Scripture with Scripture in order to conclude correctly. Now, if you notice closely, Peter here is writing to believers. He says in verse 1, "Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion." Who are they? Verse 2, "They're elect, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ." He tells them in verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time." Do they sound unsaved or saved? Saved. They were born again. They had an inheritance in heaven, and they were kept by the power of God. Now, we pick it up in verse 13. "Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind." Is he talking to believers or unbelievers? Believers, right? "Be sober. Be serious-minded. And rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you in the future at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children," are they saved or unsaved? Saved, right? "Not conforming yourself to the former lusts," like you lived before you got saved, "as in your ignorance before you got saved, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy for I am holy." And if you're not, you're not going to heaven. Didn't say that, does it? Notice clearly, the command, "Be holy for I am holy," is for the child of God. It's not for the unsaved. It's an issue of sanctification, not of justification. It's not an issue of being saved from the penalty of sin, but God now wants to save us from the power of sin. And that is why, again, he's exhorting believers to be holy, for I am holy. He's quoting the Old Testament. He also said again, you also be holy in all your conduct. That is what God wants. He wants believers to live holy lives. He wants believers to live lives set apart unto him in a very practical, godly way. But he's not saying this to be justified. He's saying it because they've been justified. He's not saying it in order for them to be saved from the penalty of sin, but to be saved from the power of sin. He's not saying this in order to go to heaven. He's saying this because they are going to heaven. And he wants them now to live a holy life. And so the clarification is, while every believer should live a holy life, this should be the result of salvation, not the means of obtaining or maintaining it. Now, I want you to notice the word should twice there. And I want you to notice the word result. That is very important that you note that. In fact, I want you to go to Ephesians chapter 2 with me. Ephesians chapter 2. Now, so often, religion gets the cart before the horse. And they say, you have to be holy, you have to do this, you have to do that, you have to do this, and you have to do that in order to be saved. And the Bible says, oh, no, 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 no. You first have to be saved and really indwelt by and then empowered by the Holy Spirit in order for good works to be the result. And that is why we start again in verse 8. For by grace you have been saved. Done deal. From the penalty of sin. How? Through faith. In who? Jesus Christ. And that salvation is not of yourself. That salvation is the gift of God. And that salvation is not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship. We who have been saved by grace through faith apart from works. And we are created, new creation in Christ Jesus, for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we, and please note it, should walk in them. It doesn't say will. It says should. It's a desired objective, but not a guaranteed result. And so as we understand the proper place of good works, we recognize again that we need to put our faith in Christ and his finished work to be saved. That enters us into salvation by grace. As we learn now to walk by faith and are empowered by the Holy Spirit, good works now can be the results. This should be true in our lives. But it doesn't guarantee it. But it's desire. It's what God wants in our lives. He wants us to live a holy life. But again, we don't live a holy life to be saved from the penalty of sin. We live a holy life because we've been saved from the penalty of sin. And now we can be saved from the power of sin. Well, we're looking forward to the day in which we'll be saved from the very presence of sin. Be holy, for I am holy, is addressing believers regarding their sanctification. It's not in reference to their justification or their glorification. And that is why you must keep clear growth truth versus birth truth. Second tense truth versus first tense truth. And again, people do not keep this clear. And you must. So does God want a holy life, students? Yes. Are you saved by a holy life? No. Should it be the result of being justified? Yes. In fact, Romans 6, 7, and 8 is going to explain to us how we can live a holy life. As a result of being declared righteous before God, by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, and his work alone, apart from law, ritual, and works. Now that leads us to another source of confusion. Believe on Jesus Christ and, again, here's the and, make Christ Lord of your life. Or something along that line. It may say you need to surrender to him as Lord. In fact, this is oftentimes how it's said these days. You need to repent from your sins and surrender your life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Now, first of all, you don't make Christ Lord. He's Lord. He's Lord before you're saved. He's Lord when you get saved. He's Lord after you're saved. You don't make him anything. That is who he is. And that's why, what must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lordship of Christ emphasizes his deity, that he is God. And when you place your faith in Christ, if you don't believe that I am, Jesus said, you will die in your sins. You are believing in God who became a man. You're believing in one who died for your sins and rose again. You are trusting in his work, not your own. Your faith is in him alone. Now, frankly, this teaching of Lordship salvation has become very, very common. But again, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and make him Lord of your life, or surrender to him as Lord. In fact, a lot of times the words are submit, or surrender, or sacrifice. That's what you can mean. Oh, and by the way, that means you're justified by faith. So they'll say you're justified by faith, but under that umbrella are a series of works, evidenced by ongoing faithfulness and fruitfulness, or you are never saved, or you can lose your salvation, depending on what persuasion they are. Now, class, does this fit into category one or category two? Category one, doesn't it? Does it keep the spotlight on Jesus Christ, or does it take it there and put it right here again, right? Which means it is a corrupted gospel. Which means salvation then isn't a gift any longer. It is a reward, because you've surrendered and you've submitted and you've repented. And you've done this and you've done that. John MacArthur, in his book, The Gospel According to Jesus, says, and I quote, his, that's the prodigal son's, demeanor was one of unconditional surrender, a complete resignation of self, an absolute submission to his Father. That is the essence of saving faith. A concept of faith that excludes obedience corrupts the message of salvation. He goes on to say, no evangelism that omits the message of repentance can properly be called the gospel, for sinners cannot come to Christ apart from a radical change of heart, mind, and will. It depends, again, what you mean by repentance. But he goes on to say, contemporary Christians have been conditioned to believe that because they recited a prayer or signed a dotted line or walked an aisle or spoke in tongues or slain in the spirit or had some other experience, they are saved. Now, in our understanding of Scripture, would we have a problem with people thinking they're saved because of those things? Absolutely. That's why, again, you've got truth mixed with error in these statements. Remember, what is the gospel? Is the gospel surrender? Submit? Repent from your sin? No, the gospel's that Christ died for your sins according to the Scripture. He was buried and he rose again the third day according to the Scripture. The gospel involves a specific person, Jesus Christ, God who became a man, a specific work that he died and he rose again, a specific accomplishment that when he died for our sins, and a specific required response, namely faith alone in Christ alone, who died for our sins and rose again. And yet, when you read these Lordship salvation teachers, they will make these kinds of statements. Jesus is Lord of all, and the faith he demands involves unconditional surrender. Now, when I hear that, my first response is, again, so have you unconditionally surrendered all areas of your life, 100% of the time, to God? Who can say that? Salvation is for those who are willing to forsake everything. How do you know you've forsaken everything? What if something comes along and you're not willing to forsake it? In fact, my estimation is, I think a lot of believers have trouble forsaking a lot of things. But notice, again, do you see the focus on Christ here in these statements? Where's the focus? Here's another one. It is a total abandonment of self-will. It is an exchange for all that we are, for all that Christ is, and denotes implicit obedience, full surrender to the lordship of Christ. Nothing less can qualify as saving faith. Now, the fact is, faith does not save you. Christ saves you. And saving faith, and I don't even like that term, but I understand what they're trying to say, the faith related to salvation, is not a special kind of faith. It's simply faith in a special kind of object, the Lord Jesus Christ and his finished work. Now, question, is the gospel about Christ's surrender on the cross, or is it about our surrender of our life? 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, and made alive by the Spirit. He surrendered to the will of God that brought him to the cross where he suffered for our sins. Salvation isn't about our surrender, it's about his surrender. And that's why years ago, William R. Newell, who wrote a classic book on the book of Romans, said it so well. He said, to preach full surrender to an unsaved man as the way of salvation will just make him a hateful Pharisee out of him. You see, the Pharisees were the ones who boasted in their surrender and their holiness and their godliness. And it was those individuals who really plotted the murder of the Lord Jesus Christ. Harry Ironsides wrote, quote, when anyone comes promising salvation to those who make full surrender of all they have to God and who pay the price of full salvation, he is preaching another gospel, for the price was paid on Calvary's cross and the work that saves is finished. It was Christ Jesus who made the full surrender when he yielded his life on Calvary that saves us, not our surrender in any way to him. Lance Latham, who was a pastor and co-founder of Awana, said, and I wrote, quote, surely we must recognize who he is, or we will die in our sins, John 8, 24. But this is vastly different from making him your Lord in your life. In other words, promising to obey the rest of your life. This latter is preaching works. And you know, to this day, to my knowledge, the Awana material is clear on the gospel. Unfortunately, many churches that are not clear use it and then add their own twist. You know, as we saw in Romans 3:24, how are we justified, students? Freely. Now, what does that cost you then? Nothing. By his grace, which means you don't earn it, you don't work for it. And why is that? Because it's through the redemption. The purchase price was paid by Jesus Christ. Now, I say that because, again, you're going to hear from lordshippers, oh, you preach cheap grace and easy believism. And again, my response is, it's not cheap. If it's cheap, that means I got to pay a little. The fact is, it's been paid in full by Christ, and I pay nothing. As far as easy believism, again, it is as easy as believing, but believing isn't always easy. Because you have to admit that your works cannot save you. You have to put your faith in a Christ you've never seen, who didn't walk on this planet the same time you've lived. You have to take God at his word. But it is as simple as belief. Thus, as we think of this condition for salvation as preached in our modern day evangelism, the word of God has no verses that teach, make Jesus Lord of your life to be saved. In fact, salvation is a matter of trusting Jesus Christ as Savior. And yet, let me quote again MacArthur. He says, the hard words of Jesus come out. It's not about you, it's about me, and sacrificing yourself to follow me. Really? Is the gospel about our sacrifice for Christ or about Christ's sacrifice for us? Hebrews 10 again says, by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifice which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. Notice, it's not about our sacrifice, it's all about his. Regarding the rich young ruler, MacArthur says, we all know someone like the rich young ruler, cocky, self-assured, impressed with his own goodness, who sees Christian salvation as one more goal he can achieve through performance of skill, money, and influence. Well, that's true. The Bible tells us that's not how it works. The goal is the unfamiliar one of sorrowfully acknowledging sin, of submission and sacrifice. If we're not willing to separate from the material things that we possess, then Jesus isn't that valuable to us. It's an all or nothing proposition. Question. Is the gospel about our sorrowfully acknowledging sin of submission and sacrifice, or is it about Christ's payment for sin, about his submission to the will of God unto death, and his sacrifice on the cross? See, walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. Again, we'll see in Romans, it's because of the love of God that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He goes on to say, they stumble over the twin truths that salvation is a free gift, yet it costs everything. Question, if it's a free gift, how can it cost you anything? Are those twin truths, or is that a contradiction? This paradox, no contradiction, may be difficult, but it's nevertheless true. Salvation is both free and costly. Sounds like a used car salesman. It is not enough to believe that only through Christ, this is J.I. Packard, and his death are sinners justified and accepted. In common honesty, we must not conceal the fact that free forgiveness, in one sense, will cost you everything. Wow. If it's free, how can it cost you anything? But this is the religious deception and delusion that is out there. Can something be both free and costly to the recipient? Is salvation both free and costly to the sinner? Does salvation cost you everything? Or was it paid in full by Christ on the cross? Again, Ephesians 1:7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. He has redeemed us to God by your blood, not our sacrifice. And that's why he says this paradox may be difficult, but it's nevertheless true. Salvation is both free and costly. Thus, in a sense, now listen to this, we pay the ultimate price for salvation when our sinful self is nailed to a cross. Wow. Salvation for sinners cost God his own son. It cost God's son his life, and it'll cost you the same thing. Now, if that isn't salvation by works, I don't know what it is. 1 Peter 1:18 tells us what the price was, and that we were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ as the Lamb, without blemish and without spot. And that's why Jesus again says it is finished. So number three, you must first be saved before you can present or yield yourself to Jesus as Lord of your life. It's not that we deny that he's Lord, and we're not even denying the fact that God wants us to present ourselves to him. What is Romans? Acts 16:31 says, first, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Ephesians 2:8-9 makes it clear it's not by works. But Romans 12:1 says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. But he's writing to brethren. He's writing to those who've already been justified. He's writing to those who've been born again. He's writing to those who have been saved from the penalty of sin. And he's now asking, in light of that grace, would you not be willing to present yourself to the Lord as an act of worship? And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove it is that good and perfect and acceptable, or perfect will of God, good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now, this raises the question about the carnal Christian, and I'm going to just touch on this. See, those that teach you have to make Christ Lord of your life have a dilemma now. If that's true, and if you have to surrender to him and submit to him, is there such a thing as a believer who lives in ongoing sin? See, how can you be submitted and sinning? How can you be surrendered and sinning? Now, they all have to admit believers sin yet. They got to allow a little wobble room, but not too much. If you sin too much, well, it's proof you're never saved. They just never tell you what the too much is. I can remember a number of years ago, I was in the Detroit area, and I stopped in at the seminary. And while I was there, I started talking to a man. And in the course of the conversation, it became clear, he told me he was a 4.5-point Calvinist. Not a full 5, 4.5. Okay? Don't ask me what the half was. Now, in the course of the conversation, we started talking about believers and sin. And I said, well, what do you do with a person who's saved and lives in carnality for 20 years? And he says, well, you can't be saved and live in carnality. I said, oh, okay, well, can you be saved and live in carnality for 20 minutes? I said, yeah. Can you be saved and be carnal for 20 months? Can you be saved and carnal? And he goes, you can be saved and carnal for 20 years. I said, well, wait a second. In my theology, you can. And in fact, if you're saved and carnal that long, God might take you home, like he was doing some of the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 11. But in your theology, you can't. Because if you live in ongoing carnality, it's proof you were never saved. How can you be surrendered and submitting and live in ongoing carnality? How could that even be true? And so, people like this usually deny the carnal Christian, and I ask myself, have you ever read the Bible? Have you ever read about the Corinthian church? What did Paul say about them? You see, John MacArthur says, those whose faith is genuine will prove their salvation is secure by persevering to the end in the way of righteousness, no matter how convincing a person's testimony might be. Once he becomes apostate, he has demonstrated irrefutably that he was never saved. Question. At the end of Solomon's life, is he worshiping false gods? Yes, sir. 1 Kings 11, right? So was he apostate? Did he lose his salvation? Was one of the writers of Scripture unsaved at the end? I mean, it's proof that he was never saved, so he was unsaved the whole time while he was writing. You've got problems with that. You got a problem with Lot. You got a problem with the Corinthians. Just read all the problems the Corinthian church had. In fact, just read what Paul said. And I, brethren, did he believe they were saved? Could not speak to you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, as to babes in Christ. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you are not able to receive it. And even now you're still not able, for you are still carnal. For where there are envy and strife and divisions among you, are you not carnal and behaving like mere men? For one says, I'm of Paul, another, I'm of Apollos. Are you not carnal? 4 times in 4 verses, he says they're carnal. And yet he says they're brethren and they are in. It is possible for someone to be saved and resist the will of God in their Christian life and fail to grow in the Lord and walk with him by faith and live in ongoing carnality. Again, it's not what God wants, but it's possible. Now, listen to what A.W. Pink wrote a number of years ago, Is Christ Your Lord? We do not ask, is Christ your Savior? But is he really and truly your Lord? If he be not your Lord, then most certainly he is not your Savior. Those who have not received Christ Jesus as their Lord and yet suppose him to be their Savior are deluded, and their hope rests on a foundation of sand. Multitudes are deceived on this vital point, and therefore, if the reader values his or her soul, we implore you to give a most careful reading to this little tract. When we ask, is Jesus your Lord, do not inquire, do you believe in the Godhood of Jesus of Nazareth? The demons do that, and yet perish notwithstanding. You may be firmly convinced of the deity of Christ and yet be in your sins. You may speak of him with the utmost reverence, accord him his divine titles in your prayers, and yet be unsaved. By the way, is that all true so far?
Yeah.
You may abominate those who traduce his person and deny his divinity, and yet have no spiritual love for him at all. That could be true. When we ask, is Christ your Lord, we mean, does he in every deed occupy the throne of your heart? Does he actually rule over your life? We have turned everyone to his own way. Isaiah 53:6 describes the course which all follow by nature. Before conversion, every soul lives to please self. Of old it was written, every man did what was right in his own eyes, and wise in those days there was no king in Israel. That is the point we desire to make to the reader. Until Christ becomes your king, until you bow to his scepter, until his will becomes the rule of your life, self dominates, and thus Christ is disowned. Yeah, in fact, he goes on to say, and unfortunately, I've cut this out. He goes on to say, if you have any reserve in your obedience, you are not saved. Wow. You mean to tell me if you're facing martyrdom and you have a reserve in your obedience, it's proof you're not saved? Wow. Now some will say, well, don't you have to obey the gospel? Yes. Romans 10:16, but they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? 2 Thessalonians tells us, since it's a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you, and to give you who are troubled rest with us, when the Lord Jesus was revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God, now watch this, and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord, from the glory of his power when he comes in that day to be glorified in the saints, and to be admired among all who believe, because our testimony among you was believe. The testimony was the gospel we preach, and notice it was believe. The way you obey the gospel, again, is by believing. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. It is a command. You say, well, what about making a commitment to Christ? Have you heard that a lot today? You need to make a commitment to Christ? Now, what does that usually mean in the thinking of people? It usually means a pledge, a promise, a commitment to obey and do something. In InterVarsity, here's a tract that says some suggested ways after presenting the gospel in conversation, Bible study, church meeting, etc. You could ask, this may be very new to you, does this make sense to you? Or how does this strike you? You could explain any confusing points. If your friend shows positive interest, you could ask, would you like to commit your life to Jesus Christ in the way we've been talking about? If your friend responds affirmatively, you should ask, would you like to do it now? There are many other ways of asking this question. Would you like to ask Jesus to become your Lord? Would you like to place your trust in Jesus as ruler over your life? Have you ever considered becoming a Christian? Would you like to become a follower of Jesus Christ? Is there any reason you don't wish to become a Christian? Now notice, in all those questions, what's totally missing? Would you like to believe Jesus Christ died for your sins and rose again? The gospel's totally missing in all of this. He goes on to say, your international friend might not be ready to make such a commitment to Christ. He or she may have some specific reasons or have reservations, in which case you could say something such as, understand, it's a big commitment. I hope you'll consider it sometime in the future. Hopefully they won't die before then. If your friend asks you, why do you want me to become a Christian? You could answer, because you're my friend, and I want you to experience all that God has for you. How about being saved from hell? Listen to this, his thinking, fears, questions, and any problem your friend might have in making a faith commitment. No matter what happens, continue to be a true friend. Here's what the navigators say in their literature. Step 4, our response. Believing means trust and commitment, acknowledging our sinfulness, trusting Christ's forgiveness, and letting him control our life. Eternal, abundant life is a gift for us to receive. How to receive Christ? Admit your need. Number two, be willing to turn from your sins. Repent. Number three, believe that Jesus Christ died for your sins on the cross and rose from the grave. Number four, through prayer, invite Jesus to come in and control your life through the Holy Spirit. Receive him as Lord and Savior. By the way, when you think of 1, 2, 3, 4, whenever I see anything like that, I'd like to say, is there even one example anywhere in Scripture where you got 1, 2, 3, 4? I mean, you know, in Jesus' evangelistic encounters and Paul's preaching, or in the book of Acts, nothing. Just one, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll be saved. They go on to say, what to pray? Dear Lord Jesus, you know I'm a sinner and need your forgiveness. I believe that you died for my sins. That's true. I want to turn from my sins. I now invite you to come into my heart and life. I want to trust and follow you as the Lord and Savior of my life. In your name, amen. And then their assurance, if you, now watch this, if you prayed the prayer and trust in Christ, then the Bible says that you can be sure you have eternal life. What verse says if you pray the prayer? You got a verse? Right? Right after the Mass. Back of your Bible. You say, well, doesn't the Bible say something about commit somewhere? 2 Timothy 1:12. For this reason I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I'm not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed. The word committed is a form of pistuo. It means entrusted. I've entrusted my eternal destiny or soul to him. How did you do that? I have believed. That's how I did it. I have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, regarding believe on Jesus Christ and make Christ Lord of your life to be saved, the clarification is this. Since Christ, Jesus Christ is Lord or God, salvation comes by simply trusting in him, not by yielding, / surrendering, sacrificing, whatever you want to call it, to him. To him. In fact, you know, John Cross uses an illustration in his book, The Stream of the Road to Emmaus. I mentioned this yesterday, but it's a great illustration. If someone's drowning, and you want to save them, as long as they are trying to save themselves, a wise rescuer will not attempt to save them. Because they're going to just create a mess and maybe even pull you down. You have to wait till they have given up all efforts to save themselves. And then you can come and grab them appropriately and pull them to shore. In the same way, it is when we've quit all attempts to try to save ourselves. We've admitted, I can't save myself. I need a Savior, and we're willing to trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and what he did. Then he saves us. Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. That's how you're saved. Okay, let's open it up for some questions before we break. I'm taking time to clarify this, not only for you, but for those who will be watching this in the future as well. Because this is review for some, but it will be new to others. And you cannot be too clear when you are explaining this to people. Now, I'm not suggesting that everyone who says some of these false responses are unsaved. They may be